man about the boy. And I know it's stupid to be mad about the boy. I'm so ashamed of it, but must admit the sleepless nights I've had about the boy.
My guest this afternoon is the very talented and soon to be household name Conor Murray, who is performing at this year's 2023 Dublin Fringe Festival. Conor, welcome to LGBTQ Plus Life.
Thank you very much. That's a very kind introduction.
Not at all, Conor. You have been so patient. It has been unbelievable because we've had a few gremlins here today. Conor, you've got to, before we talk about the play that you're in for the 2023 Dublin Fringe Festival, what's your background in, shall we say, in the arts? If you could just share that with listeners briefly.
Yeah, so I studied drama and sociology at college when I left school, and then just graduated, and then COVID happened, so there wasn't much opportunity to get involved in shows, and everything had kind of gone online. And then during COVID, I worked as a COVID swabber, and I saved up for drama school, and I ended up going to drama school last year, just gone in London. So it's nice to be able to be finished, graduated there, and come back and be working here and making shows here.
Which drama school did you go to, Conor? Give them a plug so that they'll know all about you when you hit the big notes.
They might need a reminder of who I am at the moment. I went to Mountview in London, so it's kind of southeast London, and it was a great school. It was 1 year, really, really intense. Mm-hmm. All the mad things you hear about drama school are very, very true. Mad teachers, but brilliant teachers, and really...
You then came back here, and I appreciate COVID was did you come back here because you wanted to work in Irish theatre, or this is where the openings were?
Yeah, I think I came, I only recently came back to Dublin, but I moved back because a lot of the work that I enjoy and a lot of the people that I know making work kind of my age coming up now are based here, and I think Irish theatre has always been really, really lovely to me, and it's a nice community. It's a classic case of small fish in a big pond in London. You know, it's very impersonable, you're a number on a page and that kind of thing, whereas at least in Dublin and in Ireland in general, there is more of a sense that people are willing to take a chance on someone new and see new stuff and might even stumble upon your show. I like that element too.
Yeah, no, it's interesting you should say that, because I was having lunch with somebody today who actually is a performer and a writer, and she's brought up in the UK, and I was saying one of the great things about Dublin is that we're really only about 2 degrees of separation, whereas in London it is the 6 degrees of separation. How important do you think that is to be able to, if you don't know somebody, somebody you do know knows somebody?
I think it is important. It's for me anyway, a lot of the great people I've met in theatre have been like through a show I've done, and someone knows someone else and they'll introduce you, or you go and see work that you don't know anyone and people are chatting after. It definitely feels like a community, and one that anyone can kind of go into rather than like a closed off, impenetrable kind of industry or thing. So it's a lovely, it's a nice, especially the Fringe as well. I think the Fringe fosters such a lovely atmosphere, and it's really new artists and then more established companies making work side by side. So it's so nice to be in the Dublin Fringe Festival as well.
Is this your first Dublin Fringe Festival?
It's my first one with my own work. So last year I was in a show called 24/7 Bliss, in the Dublin Fringe as well, written by Isil Dean. So it's the Dublin Fringe has been so good to me, constantly keeping me coming back, and it's so excited to be back in it this year.
Mm-hmm. We've got I don't know how conscious you are of it, but Dublin has a remarkable theatre heritage. You know, we go back centuries even, but we have a great shall we say, love of theatre. Did that come through when you were growing up? Was that something you were conscious of?
Absolutely, I think so. I know I didn't have much of a knowledge of any of the like classics or the writers or the, you know, kind of our literary heritage growing up. It was just, I loved going to shows and seeing work and yeah, I think it was part of growing up in Dublin, going to shows, and I was in the Dublin Youth Theatre, and just seeing the work that was being put on by different companies was definitely what made me want to study it.
And sadly, before they went a bit onto, shall we say, on the poor mouth, we used to have some really fabulous theatres. The Gaiety was one, the Olympia. Now they've got a bit dishevelled in the meantime. We used to have the Theatre Royal, we had the Regal, we had a whole range, and the Old Abbey as well. But nevertheless, the environment has still continued. This year you're playing at Bewley's, one of the more, what I call, more intimate venues. Where did you play last year, just as a matter of interest, Conor?
Last year we were in the Black Box in Smock Alley Theatre. Mm-hmm. So it was small. I think it was a slightly larger capacity than Bewley's is. But I love Bewley's. It's intimate, it's face-to-face, it's kind of, there's no hiding behind a set or anything. It's very much you and the audience and the story you're telling, and I think it works really well for just a minute.
And not only that, you can get a good cup of coffee before and afterwards.
Exactly, so no one's falling asleep during the performance. No one has an excuse to, everyone has to be there with you awake. So yeah, no, it's nice, and Bewley's is so quintessentially Dublin. It's so nice to be performing there as well.
Mm-hmm. Well, again, it was something I was discussing when I was your age. We used to go into a Bewley's a lot because it was like the headquarters of hippiedom. And you'd go in there into the basement. I don't know if the basement is still there. And you'd get about eight or nine hippies and about four old dowagers. It was it was just something from another world. I suspect that's why we actually loved it. And I suspect you might have loved it as well if you were there in those days.
Maybe we'll bring a bit of hippiedom back now when the Fringe is on for the 2 weeks.
But for some of us, even though the hair might have gone away, the attitude has never gone away. Now, the play we're talking about, which is called Just a Minute, if I'm incorrect.
Yes, yeah.
Couple of things on that one. First of all, Just a Minute used to be a very popular radio program with Kenneth Williams. Did any of that was that any of that influenced into it at all, or was that did you just like the phrase?
It wasn't. You know, it was something that's come up as well. The Just a Minute quiz with Larry Gogan as well. My mum was going, everyone's going to think it's about Larry Gogan. It's like his life story or something. I was going, okay, maybe I should have thought of this, but I think it's just a phrase that constantly comes up throughout the play, and if it has other meanings, it serves the purpose of, you know, you have a short amount of time, you got to make it work, which is kind of underlying in the play. But it was definitely, when I did it in the UK, I developed this as part of my course. Like, we have to develop a play for ourselves, a one person show, and when I did it in the UK, they were saying, there is a quiz show called Just a Minute. I don't know if that'll work. Everyone is going to think it's the quiz show. But I was very stubborn and I kept the name. So maybe it's to my detriment. But
maybe somewhere in the recesses of the, you know, of the universe, you heard it. Well, all I can say is, if you never heard Kenneth Williams, Kenneth Williams was the absolute master at improvisation, and where he had, you know, you had to talk for a minute nonstop without deviating or anything like that. And Kenneth Williams was the absolute master at it. He has to be listened to be believed. So you wrote this play as well. Am I right in thinking that?
I did. It's the first play I've ever written. So I wrote it, and that's very scary because I'm used to acting things, but I'm not used to acting things that I've written. So not having that little bit of separation between the writer and the actor, it's a strange one. But I've enjoyed it. It's been a great process. But It's
I'm going to
definitely
pick your
different.
brain here, Connor, for somebody who has gone through the formal process, because I've been doing some writing with some people over the last, particularly over the summer. So can I ask you, when you approach the writing side of it, which do you gravitate towards? Characterization, dialogue, narrative even?
Character, always character for me. I think that's probably the acting side of thing coming through, but I want to think about loads of things about the person that will never ever make it into the play and somehow let them influence your writing. I always definitely would go from character. It's structure, and I mean that narrative as well, side by side with character, but structure is the real problem for me. I really have to write everything down on post-it notes and get it out and cram it into some kind of a dramatic structure, but because my brain just doesn't work that way automatically. It definitely runs to character first.
What about dialogue? Because I'm a huge fan of dialogue, but I think dialogue, really good dialogue, is actually quite difficult to write. And
Absolutely.
I think you need a very good ear to be able to write good dialogue. How did you approach that? Did you essentially use the world around you and what you hear?
Yeah, I think the story in just a minute is about an intern who is trying to climb the ranks and finding it very, very difficult. And it's the most important day of his career, and it doesn't go as he's planned. And I've done a lot of internships, having finished college, and I kind of wrote down little notes while I was in those internships of just thoughts I had or ideas for a story. And I ended up revisiting them when I had to create this show. I was making this show. So I think I definitely had some baseline material there to work off of. But dialogue, you're dead right, is so hard to write. But you get a little bit of a cop out now when it's a one person show, because it's more of a stream of consciousness and someone's inner world that you're building rather than a realistic world, or you're not writing, heavy dialogue between two characters. So it's a nice way in, I have to say, for the first play that you're writing, a one person show.
Again, well, I'm going to give you just from my recent experience, I've tended to use dialogue with accents to ground it in space and time. So what I'm doing at the moment has very heavy North Dublin accents, just so that people will then realize, well, these aren't people that are coming from Dalkey, or these aren't people that are coming from Killiney. Does that fit into your way of thinking?
I think so. I think accent is, of course, a great way to characterize someone. I think intern for me, the character is quite similar to myself in many, many ways. But it is good to sprinkle accent, especially when it's just one person. It's such a clear way. You can do it with your physicality, you can do it with accent, you can do it with your tone, your pitch, or there's loads of different ways to make different characters clear when you're performing. But accent is a great way in. And we had to study accent in drama school as well. Like, we were forced to, I had to do my Shakespeare in an RP accent, which I dreaded, because I don't know, there's something about having to do something in a certain way, and I understand accent is a very important thing, but I'm proud of my accent. I don't think Shakespeare should have to be done in a classical way.
You're not a method actor, are you, Connor?
No, well, I'm not there yet. I'll try anything once, but we're not there yet. I think my family would get sick of me now if I was doing method at home.
Well, some people think method is the last word in acting, and other people think it's incredibly pretentious. So, as I say, it very excuse me, it very much depends on who you're dealing with.
I won't knock until I've tried it, but I haven't yet.
But when you were at, particularly when you were at theatre school, you must have been in productions with different other groups of people. How do you find doing a solo show versus, as I say, being part of a troupe?
It's very different. When you're playing against someone, you can feed off their energy, you're bouncing. It's new because someone else gives you a different offer on a different night. whereas that's all coming from you in a one person show, which is the challenge of it, to keep your energy going for 45 minutes and to remember your notes from the night before, and also make it completely new and exciting depending on what are the audience reacting to, what are they, you know, are they quieter than last night, are they different? So it's a different kind of a way to approach it. Mm-hmm. but I enjoy the challenge as well, I really do, and it's great having Emma Finegan, the director, in the room to bounce off, and she's so focused and with you the whole performance. So it is at the stage now we're into runs, and I'm excited now to get it in front of an audience, because I think that's where it's going to slot into place.
I mean, because of the theme of the play, as you say, it's about a young man in a corporate environment who has a bit of a shine to somebody who probably isn't LGBT, or at least if he is, he's probably very well disguised. And without going into it too much, you probably could have put this through for the Gay Theatre, the Dublin International Gay Theatre Festival, rather than the Fringe. Was that an option, or did you decide that the Fringe is somewhere you feel more comfortable with?
No, I definitely would have. So when I was finishing up in drama school, would have been the time that the Gay Theatre Festival was on. So I would have missed the submission. And I do think that it fits into the Fringe call out is City Limitless. It's about, you know, the releasing the limitations of Dublin, and the Fringe call out for submissions this year definitely really, really spoke to me, and especially to this show. So I felt like the Fringe was its right home, but the timings didn't. But the Gay Theatre Festival is fabulous. It's really, really good. I was meant to be actually involved in a show in the Gay Theatre Festival in 2020, but obviously COVID had happened. It was another thing that COVID had messed up. But but there's brilliant work in there, and it absolutely could have slotted in as well.
Yeah, well, I think I saw about 6 or 7 productions at this year's, and then I went to the gala awards at the end of it, and it's a fabulous event. Maybe next year. You could have also, of course, gone to Seen and Heard, which is another great festival of new work. Are these avenues that you would like to investigate as well?
Absolutely. I'd love to submit some new work to Seen and Heard next year. It's such a good festival, for trying something, seeing if it works, not having to you know, have it fully ready and polished and good to go. It's good for kind of dipping your toe in the water, and it's great that they've stepped in and kind of made a festival where that's available to artists. So yeah, absolutely, I'd love to be involved in Seeing It Hurt.
Yeah, I mean, you said you played, was it Spock Holly you played last year, and this year it's going to be the Bewleys small theatre as well. How do you find the two by contrast? Because while there's not an enormous difference in terms of size, I think there is quite a difference in terms of atmospherics, because Bewley's is wooden and small, you know, low ceilings, and you can see the audience. It seems to me to be a slightly warmer environment, whereas although I like Smock Alley, there's a certain coldness about the, say, the boys' school and the black box down there. How do you, as a performer, relate to that? Or
yeah, I think the black box space in Smock Alley is just that, a black box. You can kind of make it whatever you want of it. Whereas Bewley's, I feel like when you perform in it, it's a smaller stage, and no matter really what you do on the stage, it still feels like Bewley's, you know? So there's a certain amount of performing in that warm atmosphere, a coffee shop, more slightly more casual, I would say, which I think really serves this show, because it's direct address, and it's about, you know, kind of bringing people into this one person story and telling it that way, whereas Smock Alley is definitely more suited to more front on shows where
dramatic work, I would call it. That's it.
Yeah, yeah.
I have to ask you here, because the press release we got that says, if you're a recovering workaholic, a Colin the Caterpillar fanatic or simply looking for a laugh, this show is for you. What's Colin the Caterpillar got to do with the show? I have to ask you that.
I can't give everything away, but he does, of course, he does make an appearance. So if you come and see the show, it is explained. But he does feature heavily. He's, you know, he actually should be credited as another actor, I imagine.
I have to confess my ignorance here. I'm of that generation that hasn't a clue who Colin the Caterpillar is. So I'm just wondering, is he a bit like Kevin the Carrot that's on the Aldi advertisements at the moment?
He's kind of he's an icon of our generation, I'd say. He's quintessential kids' birthday parties. Everyone he's there. So he's, and look, if you don't know him, you'll definitely be introduced to him when you come to the show.
And what about the workaholic? I mean, we're Irish people, we're not known workaholics. You know, we work hard, but we're not known workaholics. Alcoholics, maybe, but not workaholics.
Well, I think the character intern is a workaholic. He's trying to distract himself from his own life. He's kind of putting himself into this work as a way of getting away from himself and his problems and overthinking. So it's kind of his distraction technique. He becomes obsessed.
And you talk about the play describing somebody who's trying to, shall we say, not so much deny, but to dilute what you describe as his queerness. Was that something when you were doing these interns that you felt that was necessary? I suppose the way to put it is the corporate environment somewhat less LGBT friendly than they would have us believe at the Pride Parade?
The Pride Parade and the rainbow lanyards. Yeah. I think it, whatever about corporate intention and what they're trying to do now, which is great, but I think, for me, it was more about my tendency to revert back to my own kind of protection mechanism, which is to be quiet,
defense mechanism,
and look after yourself. And it was more of an atmosphere that was the fallback for me. So that it's more about, that was my reaction to the corporate environment and exploring in a character how sometimes in a corporate environment that we can go back to old habits and you know, like coping mechanisms from secondary school or growing up, that to lessen yourself and be quiet and just get through and focus on what you have to do, and don't, you know, you have this rich inner world, but you're not sharing it out because you don't know the reaction if you did.
It's interesting you should say that, because that was very much the case with people of my generation. Nowadays, we're led to believe that everybody is out there and accepting, but I suspect that's probably a standard we like to believe happens, but it isn't quite always like that in reality.
Yeah, and I think even if the, you know, majority is that it the corporate world, or at least how it seems what it's marketed on Pride Month, is that it is accepting, there is still obviously very personal journeys happening within that to, you know, self-acceptance and self-love and personal pride, regardless of what's happening, you know. Yeah. In the office, there's definitely very, very personal stories happening around that as well. So this is one of them.
Play is described as a comedy, but I suspect there's a lot more emotion flows through it. What emotions or what perspective would you like people to come away with from watching Just a Minute, Conor?
I think I'd like people to come away with a sense of that their time is their own, and that a small little revolution in your own life is still life-changing and big. It doesn't have to be necessarily a huge movement or dramatic, that often, you know, it's not a pride parade, but it's this personal sense of pride that you have at the end of the day that is just as affirming to, you know, to queerness and your identity and yourself. So that's, but you're right, it is. I always find that some of the most emotional moments in my life have been coupled with some of the funniest moments in my life. So I think I tried to get that through in the play, that for every time you're having a cry, afterwards, you have the best laugh. You know, it kind of, life has a way of balancing it out. So hopefully that comes through in the play as well.
Well, isn't that the essence of theatre, with the mask of the tragedy and the comedy all
exactly.
interlinked? Yeah. Conor, let's just have a quick look at the important bits, what we refer to as the bums on seats moment. Tell people, yes, when is the play being performed, where is it being performed, and how they can get to go and see it? Mm-hmm.
Perfect. So the play is on from the 14th to the 17th of September. Mm-hmm. So we have, there's varied times throughout that. Sure. So we have a matinee at 1 p.m. on the Thursday and the Friday.
And that's the 15th and the 16th, am I right?
You're right. The 14th and the 15th. Mm-hmm. And I'm going to start this again. Because
the 15th and the 16th are when we have 1 p.m. shows, am I correct there? And I have it in front of me, Conor. And you've also then, you've got a preview on the 14th, is that correct? At 1 p.m., at lunchtime?
1 p.m., yeah. Mm-hmm. So it's Bewley's, it's lunchtime, so you can get your coffee, and the show is 45 minutes long, so you'll be out before your boss gives you a call to get back to work.
Yeah.
And we have some evening shows as well. And we'd love to see people there. You can get tickets on the Fringe website, and the show mm-hmm. is just in place.
Do they have a box office in Bewley's, or what's the situation there?
The Fringe box office, I think the physical one isn't open yet. It used to be in the new theatre. I think it's there again mm-hmm. This year.
Okay. Well,
online is the best way to get them. And Bewley's will send you back to the Fringe website as well.
Conor, I have every confidence that you're going to be brilliant. I have every confidence that people are going to love Just a Minute. So, as we say, in the theatre, break a leg.
Thank you so much. Thank you for having me on.
You're very welcome. So that's Conor Murray. He's got a fabulous new play for the Dublin Fringe Festival called Just a Minute. And we're recommending everybody go and see it and have a great either lunchtime or evening. So, Conor, thanks for your time today.
Thank you so much.
About the boy, and I know it's stupid to be mad about the boy. I'm so ashamed of it, but must admit the sleepless nights I've had about the boy.